Good morning. My name is Justin Beatty, and I'm one of the pastors here at People's United Methodist Church in Oregon, Wisconsin. I'd like to welcome you this morning to the streaming premiere of our Sunday worship service. I'd also like to remind you that if there's anything in this service that is particularly meaningful to you, then I would invite you to put it in the comments down below. So today we are continuing with our Lenten sermon series again and again. And hopefully the idea that will come through in that series is that even though bad things happen, even though again and again we see the brokenness in this world, every time lives are taken unjustly, or every time the powerful choose corruption and violence, every time we feel like screaming out into the heavens, again, how long, oh God? In the midst of that despair, God comes to us. Again and again. Again and again, God offers us the sacred refrain, I choose you, I love you, I will lead you to repair. Again and again, God breaks the cycle and offers us a new way forward. At the risk of beating a dead horse, we are observing this Lenten season at an interesting time in our history, when much is unclear. But even if, as we come together to worship God, we have to do so while physically apart, if we come to God again and again with our prayers, our dreams, our hopes, and our doubts, if we continue to choose each other again and again, we will continue to be a community. We will continue to love both God and each other with the same persistence that God continues to love, choose, and claim us. And now I'd like to invite you to sing with us as we continue to worship the living God.
Spoken to me. My name is Lori Kelly. One of the practices that is important to our faith life is the act of confessing and receiving forgiveness, not just as individuals, but as a community. It is an opportunity for us to both reflect on our lives and how we are called to grow, as well as a time to remember that God actively forgives us when we have fallen short in our discipleship and helps us to grow and try again. During the season of Lent, our worship service will include a call to confession, prayer of confession, and words of forgiveness as we focus on this practice as a community of faith. Often, the first step to change is listening. We have to listen to those we've hurt. We have to listen to creation as she cries. We have to listen to the voice of the oppressed if we are ever to hope to make things right. So today, as we begin our prayer of confession, we will start with a moment of silence, a moment to listen. And then we will pray together, trusting that God is always listening to us, and that God's ears listen with love. So let us confess silently and then together. Listening God, take what is closed in us and open it. Take what is distracted in us and settle it. Take what is hurting in us and hold it. Take any and all parts of us that create distance from you. For we are like Peter, O God. We argue what we don't know. We fear what we cannot see. We almost always speak sooner than we listen. So open us, settle us, hold us, and forgive us. We long to hear you more clearly. We long to know you more fully. With hope we pray, and with gratitude we confess. Amen. Siblings in Christ, we confess with gratitude because we know that God already has heard and forgiven us. No matter what we have done or left undone, we are held in God's hand. So rest in this good news. God invites us in. God meets us where we are. God hears our prayers. God forgives us. Thanks be to God for a love like that.
Amen. Well, good morning again, and a special hello to any kids who may be watching. So in a little bit, Lori, a grown-up in the church, is going to read us a Bible story. And then the story for today, Jesus is talking with his followers, his disciples. And you know, what he's saying to them this time, it's not exactly pleasant. He's telling them that he's going to have to go through some really hard and painful things. That he's going to die, actually. But that he's going to rise again. He's telling them the story of Easter, basically, before it happens. And one of his disciples, Peter, is just not having it. See, Peter, he's got an idea of how he thinks Jesus' life is going to go or should go. And it's quite a different idea than what Jesus just said. So Peter takes Jesus aside and actually lectures him. You should probably point out, Jesus is God. But Peter is lecturing him about how this can't possibly be, how things are going to happen. It's a pretty courageous move, lecturing God about how wrong God is. If you read more of the Gospels, one of the things that you'll find is that Peter doesn't always think before he opens his mouth or before he acts. Maybe you know people like that. Maybe. It seems like Peter's got this idea that he's got everything figured out. And he's so eager to show people how smart he is, how he's got everything figured out, that sometimes he puts his foot in his mouth, which is an expression that means that, you know, sometimes he says things that make him look a little silly sometimes. You know, like when he takes it upon himself to correct God. I think that thinking before you speak, just slowing down and maybe taking a breath when you're talking to someone, it not only helps you to avoid saying things that make you look silly, but it actually gives you some space to actually listen sometimes to the other person that you're talking with. Like if Peter had actually just taken a minute to actually listen to what Jesus had to say, then maybe he would have caught that part on the end where Jesus talked about coming back to life after 3 days. Not something you hear often. You would think that hearing something like that would have made Peter a little curious about what God was planning through with all this hard stuff that Jesus was going to have to go through. And, you know, instead of telling God what he thought the plan was, maybe he would have asked some more questions, which, you know, might have gone a little better for him. I think that for us too, slowing down, thinking and listening before we speak, it can be hard. It's not something that the people around us maybe do very much. A lot of people who speak before they think, before they give themselves a chance to listen to the other person, well, they end up looking kind of silly, like Peter did. So as you go this week, as you go to school, when you play or talk with your friends, maybe try to take a second to slow down and listen to them. And when you pray this week, if you pray, then take a couple seconds to slow down then too. And try to listen to see if there's anything that God is trying to tell you. Would you please pray with me? Dear God, I know that it's hard to think and listen sometimes. We're just so excited to speak. I pray that you would be with us this week, that you would help us to slow down, to take the time to listen to others, and to listen to you as well. In your Son's name we pray. Amen.
In my wrestling and in my doubts, in my failures, you won't walk out. Your great love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Oh, Paul, you are the peace in my troubled sea. In the silence, you won't let go. Your truth will hold. Your great love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Whoa, you are the peace in my troubled sea.
Safe to shore.
Just before the beginning of our scripture reading from the book of Mark, Jesus asked the disciples who people thought Jesus was. Peter proclaimed that he thought Jesus was the Messiah. That insight led Jesus to call Peter the rock, upon which he would build his church. In the Gospels of Matthew and Luke, however, the conversation between Peter and Jesus quickly turns in today's reading. From the Gospel of Mark, chapter 8, verse 31, through chapter 9, verse 8. Then he began to teach them that the Son of Man must undergo great suffering and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the scribes, and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. He said all this quite openly, and Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But turning and looking at his disciples, he rebuked Peter and said, "Get behind me, Satan, for you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things." He called the crowds with the disciples and said to them, "If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it. And those who lose their life for my sake and for the sake of the gospel will save it. For what will it profit them to gain the whole world and forfeit their life? Indeed, what can they give in return for their life? Those who are ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of them the Son of Man will also be ashamed when it comes in the glory of his Father with the holy angels." He said to them, "Truly, I tell you, there are some standing here who will not taste death until they see that the kingdom of God has come with power." 6 days later, Jesus took him with Peter and James and John and led them high up on a mountain apart by themselves, and he was transfigured before them, and his clothes became dazzling white, such as no one on earth could bleach them. And there appeared to them Elijah with Moses, who were talking with Jesus. Then Peter said to Jesus, "Rabbi, it is good for us to be here. Let us make 3 dwellings, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He did not know what to say, for they were terrified. Then a cloud overshadowed them, and from the cloud there came a voice, "This is my Son, the Beloved. Listen to him." Suddenly, when they looked around, they saw no one with them anymore, but only Jesus. the Word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Thank you for sharing our reading this morning, Lori. My name is Jason Mankey. I'm one of the pastors at People's United Methodist Church in Oregon, Wisconsin, and I'm so pleased to be worshiping with you this day. One of the nice things, I think, about so many churches posting their worship services online is the fact that it's easier for me to be able to experience a worship service on a regular basis other than the one I lead. This is something I haven't been able to do since I was, well, about 20 years old. I'm listening to and participating in these different worship services, and as I do so, I think I'm able to get a sense of the congregation that is worshiping virtually as well, through the type of music that's played, through the types of sermons that are preached, and through the prayers that are shared. From many of the sermons I've heard, I get the sense that the congregation being preached to is gathered to get to know God better, the God who comes to us through Jesus, the God who comes to us through the Scriptures, the God who walks with us each and every day through the Holy Spirit. So there is a lot of conversation in these types of messages about who God is and what that means for us, so we can have a sure and more certain faith. In about just as many messages, I listen to the pastor's sermon and I get the sense that the people are expecting something utilitarian and practical from both the sermon and from God. Having a problem with your marriage? Struggling with your finances? Do you want to find fulfillment and joy? Well, just follow these five principles that God gave us here in the Scripture, and you'll have what you need for life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Or something like that. I know I've preached both of these types of sermons over the years. If you're really into this preaching stuff, you can get into debates about the purpose of a sermon, the pros and cons of all of the different types of sermons, and which ones actually express the gospel's message better. What people want to hear versus what people need to hear, and well, so on and so forth. And I don't think these conversations, at least for most people, are all that interesting. But I bring all of this up because every once in a while, we encounter a passage like today's, which throw all of the typical approaches to sermonizing just out the window. It makes us say things like, wow, if there's something applicable to my life in this passage, I don't want it. And, well, I guess I didn't know God as well as I first thought. In fact, readings like the one Lori read this morning is why the old profession seems so true to our hearts and minds. The old profession that says, yes, I believe there is a God, and I know I'm not her. So Jesus' disciples have been walking with Jesus for a while. They've had a front row seat from which to observe his many works, including healings and exorcisms. They've heard him teach and preach. They've marveled as Jesus has drawn larger and larger crowds. Maybe they've thought to themselves, hey, this Jesus movement is really taking off. People are being drawn to him. Maybe this really proves that Jesus is actually the long-awaited Messiah. It's at this point in the gospel that Jesus moves from teaching and working with the crowds to specifically addressing the 12 disciples. Before today's reading, Jesus asks the 12 who people think he is. and more pointedly, who they, the 12, think Jesus is. And Peter proclaims that Jesus is the Messiah. Jesus confirms Peter's statement, but then moves on immediately to say that he will be rejected, he will suffer, and he will die. Now, this goes totally against what the disciples believe the Messiah is supposed to do. True, Jesus mentions something about a resurrection, but it's obvious in Peter's response that they couldn't comprehend what in the world Jesus meant by that. So Peter immediately rebukes Jesus for saying something so outrageous. The disciples, in the middle of their journey with Jesus, had been expecting a message that confirmed what they had already thought and knew about God and the Messiah. Instead, Jesus surprises them by teaching them that they are walking a way that nobody wants to go. They are walking not toward glory and power, but toward rejection, suffering, and death. Back to our conversation about sermon topics. A lot of times we pastors strive to find some overarching theme or sermon series that would be attractive to folks who are listening, not only in the congregation, but to the greater community as well. Something like lonely, anxious, check out our next sermon series and we'll fix all of that. Imagine how many people would be attracted to our church if we advertised the next sermon series by saying, looking for more pain, anxiety, and suffering and stress in your life? Well, you've come to the right place, because that's just what we're going to be talking about in our next sermon series as we join the journey with Jesus. And yet, maybe we can consider this moment of Jesus turning to teach the 12 as his turning to teach those of us who've been on this journey of faith with him for quite some time. Because there are times we get confused about what it means to be a follower of Jesus. Sometimes we think that following Jesus is a wise choice because it will enable us to live the lives that we want, the lives we think we must have, and will allow us to avoid pain and seek pleasure, which, by the way, is very natural for us. It's actually quite unnatural for us to give our lives to the one whose message is, deny yourself, take up your cross and follow. Can this be who God really is? Is this the path we need to walk if we want to be close to God? Recently, I was reading about a television show where a doctor was talking about brain plasticity. The doctor said that as we age, our brains quite naturally seek to protect us from stress. The doctor said, our brains are lazy. They tell us to seek the easy way, rather than the way that requires more thought and effort. So when you are faced with some challenging task, like walking up or down a set of stairs, your brain says, in effect, hey, why bother with that? Let somebody else fetch whatever it is you need. You deserve a rest. That's why it can take a good amount of effort to get out of bed in the morning for many older adults. Your brain is telling you, rest, relax. What do you have to get out of bed for? The doctor went on to say, that a main way to resist the debilitating effects of aging is to push ourselves, to put ourselves under some stress intentionally in order to make our brains work harder than they would like to work. So, our brains tell us to take it easy, to be good to ourselves, to take the easy path. And yet something moved you to tune into worship today. Your daring to listen to Jesus. You're bold enough to take Jesus' teachings more seriously than lots of the lessons that the world has told you about what you need. Though you could have taken the road more traveled, you have decided to walk behind Jesus down his path. Friends, give yourself credit today. Jesus is saying words to us that we can't say to ourselves. He is telling us truth that maybe we'd rather not hear. God saves through the path of suffering love. More than that, Jesus calls us to walk with him down this path. He doesn't only say that he is going to take up the cross, but there will be crosses for each of us to bear. And yet, though these are tough words to hear, here you are. You are here walking with Jesus. This Lent, we will find that we will be challenged by Jesus' words again and again until we not only see Jesus go to the cross, but we will feel some of the weight of the cross on our shoulders as well. We do so, trusting, hoping, and knowing that just beyond what we can see on this Lenten road is the light of Easter, which has the power to transform not only us, but all of creation. Amen.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. To see you high. Shining in the as we sing, holy, 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 I want to see you.
Hey everybody, it's Ann Meyer talking about our pre-recorded Hallelujah Chorus, which will be presented on Easter morning. The deadline is next Sunday, March 7th. You still have time to grab a piece of music, ask for a vocal track, and lay down your recording. Want to know more? Email me, Ann, A-N-N-E, at peoplesumc.org.
Thank you, Ann. Have you missed seeing some of the youth and young adults in our church? You can see some of them on Mondays on either our Facebook page or YouTube channel as they share a Lenten devotional poem. Need help getting to those pages? Just visit peoplesumc.org.
And now, would you please join me in our pastoral prayer? And as a reminder, if you have any joys or concerns, you can email either Jason or myself at jason@peoplesumc.org or justin@peoplesumc.org, or you could email our office at office@peoplesumc.org, or you can put them in the comments down below. I'd also like to take a second to invite you to help us populate our prayer wall. During this Lenten season, we are using these banners behind me to create a bit of a prayer wall. And how that's going to work is you can either mail your prayer request into the church, or you can email us and we'll print that prayer request out for you, and then we'll attach it to these banners. Ideas for themes in your prayers include prayers of petition, thanksgiving, lament, confession, intercession, or adoration, or just whatever's on your heart that you want to tell God. Our hope is by the time that Easter rolls around, we'll have gotten so many prayers that as great as these banners look, we won't be able to see them anymore. They'll just be so covered with your prayers. So again, those email addresses are jason@peoplesumc.org, justin@peoplesumc.org, and office@peoplesumc.org. Now, would you please pray with me? God, thank you for today. Thank you for the opportunity that we have to come together and to worship you. Thank you for keeping us relatively safe during the pandemic and for keeping us relatively safe during the recent extreme weather here in Wisconsin. And we pray that you would continue to be with those in Texas and elsewhere who are still suffering or who have lost a loved one during the storm or the recent power outages there. Thank you that people are starting to be able to get their vaccines. And we pray that that process would go smoothly, that more and more of us would be able to get those shots, and that as a result, we would be able to start seeing each other in person more. We pray as well that you would be with people who are still suffering because of COVID, either because they themselves or a loved one are sick, or because perhaps a loved one may have passed away. We pray that you would continue to be with them and to walk alongside them during this difficult time. We pray all these things as your Son taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And now it is time for us to take a moment to remember that one of the ways in which we put our faith into action is by giving our tithes and offerings. And as a reminder, you can give your tithes and offerings multiple ways. Either you could go to the church's website, or you could donate using our smartphone app. Our website is peoples@umc.org, I should mention. Or if you'd rather, you can mail a physical check to the church, whichever of these you're more comfortable with. And today, for our ministry celebration, we are lifting up these Lenten devotional booklets. We had something similar during Advent, and what we've heard is that many of you really appreciated them, so we're bringing them back. The intent is for them to help us to look at the scriptures from the sermons that week in several different ways. There are poems and art and some reflections in there. Here is a piece of art, for example. Most of you should have gotten this booklet in your Lenten mailing that we sent out a couple weeks ago. But if for some reason you didn't get one, or if you're just joining us, if this is your first week, welcome. And also you can request a Lenten devotional booklet from our office at office@peoplesumc.org, or you can also access the material from our smartphone app. And one of the reasons why we're able to provide this material to you free of charge is through the generosity of your tithes and offerings. So thank you for that.
Praise God throughout these passionate days. Praise Christ our Lord, whom God did raise. And praise the Spirit who imparts God's love in Christ into us. Amen.
Please pray with me this prayer of thanksgiving. What will it profit us to gain the whole world and forfeit our life? With all humility, let us make our offering to God, trusting not in worldly gain, but in God's sustaining grace. Almighty God, accept these offerings with the dedication of our lives, that we may be for the world a sign of your abiding love and a testament to your enduring promise. In Christ, by the power of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen.
my friends, receive this charge and blessing. As followers of Jesus, let us strive not to avoid the way of the cross, but to follow wherever Jesus may lead. And may the blessing of God uphold you along the way. Amen. Have a fantastic week, friends.